Yes, so let me start by thanking the organizers for the invitation to this prestigious and super interesting conference so far. I'm also supposed to say that because this presentation is based on joint work with a number of co-authors, someone like Felipe Alves is at the Bank of Canada, and Birka Enoreste, that you probably all know well, at ECB, the views expressed here are mine and do not necessarily reflect those of ECB or those of the Bank of Canada. All right, so I want to try to summarize my message in the first slide of my presentation. My starting point here is that the distribution of income and wealth is central to much of economics. Think about labor economics. In labor, there is much research. There has been a lot of research in the last 10, 15 years, 20 years on the evolution of skill and task premia, and therefore wage inequality in response to technical change. In public economics, the distribution of income is key, for the understanding the optimal design of taxes and transfers. In macro itself, in most of macro, there is quite a bit of research on the determinants of wealth inequality, both in the cross-section and over time. And even in finance, that tradition has been kind of monopolized by three models, habits, rare disasters, and longer risk, which are represented in vision models. There's an active area of research on heterogeneous preferences and insurable income risk. Instead, until recently, distribution of income and wealth played almost essentially no role in monetary economics. So the science of monetary policy has been dominated largely by representation paradigm, and the practice of monetary policy has been greatly influenced by this perspective, from which we obviously learn a lot. But my point today, my message today, is that the distribution of income and wealth matters for how monetary policy transmits to the real economy. In order to make this point, I think it's helpful to start from kind of recapping what the transmission mechanism of monetary policy is in the representative agent version of the Keynesian model. Okay? For this purpose, I'm going to sketch out really a stylized model, one that can be solved in closed form. The model is in continuous time. The representative agent has CRI preferences with intertemporal substitution equal to 1 over gamma and discounts the future trade rho. Remember that in this model, the representative household is also a permanent income consumer, and therefore rho is essentially also the marginal consumer out of transitory income for the representative household. Technology is very simple. Output is equal to the total amount of labor supply, and there is no labor preferences. Also, we're assuming that prices are perfectly rigid. Here's where essentially we can get the closed form solution, but this is not really a particularly restrictive property or assumption from the point of view of the insight that this stylized model gives you. The monetary authority sets the time path of the nominal interest rate, which is also the real rate here because the prices are rigid. R0 is the monetary shock at impact, and the shock decays at rate eta. At large eta means that the shock is very transitory, small eta is very persistent. And 1 over eta is the average duration of the shock. The equilibrium is very simple here. It's market clearing the goods market, consumption equal to output, and we're focusing on one equilibrium where consumption goes back to steady state, initial steady state. Okay? So it's straightforward to show that the impact effect at t equals 0 of a monetary policy shock is given by this formula here, minus 1 over gamma eta. Okay. So essentially, it's a product of 1 over gamma, which is the intertemporal and 1 over eta, which is the average duration of the shock. Okay. So essentially, for a given duration of the shock, the higher is intertemporal substitution, the higher is the effect of the impact effect of the shock on aggregate consumption. Okay, but let's sort of dig a little bit into this formula. Let's try to understand the transmission mechanism of the monetary shock to consumption in this model. In work with Kaplan-Moll, which is sort of suggests the composition, right? Where an impulse response function of, say, an aggregate quantity, say, consumption to a monetary policy shock, can be decomposed into two channels essentially. The first channel is what we call the direct effect of the monetary policy shock effect of the interest rate on individual and aggregate consumption. Okay? This is kind of a partial equilibrium channel keeping income constant. The second channel is the indirect effect through the change, through the general equilibrium change in disposable income that is induced by the monetary policy shock. Okay? And here, essentially, this is what happens in the economy is that after the shock, equilibrium prices are going to change. So the wage is going to change, asset prices are going to change, or in a labor market with frictions, where wages don't move very much, employment would change and they would increase burdens. Also, fiscal variables will change because the intertemporal budget of the government has to adjust, so taxes and transfer will change. This is all part of this general equilibrium. What is a transmission mechanism? It's essentially a decomposition of the error rate into direct and indirect effects. So once you do this decomposition in our special case, you obtain essentially that the direct response to the interest rate is given by the simple formula eta over rho plus eta, and the indirect effect is given by rho over rho plus eta. Remember that rho is the marginal cost to consume essentially in this model. Now think about a plausible, very straightforward quarterly parameterization of this model, where rho, the discount rate, is about 2% per year, so 0.5% quarterly, and eta, which is this decay rate, is 0.5, which corresponds to kind of a half-life of 2 quarters, which is roughly the half-life of monetary policy shocks. Then, if you plug in these numbers into this decomposition, it's straightforward to see that the direct component contributes for almost entirely the transmission mechanism monetary policy. Eta over rho plus eta is close to 0.99 in the simple exercise. And why? Well, basically because eta is 2 orders of magnitude greater than rho, and because rho, which is the MPC in this model, is extremely small at the quarterly frequency. Okay? So basically, in this model, there is no really, sort of the size of the Keynesian general equilibrium multiplier is really tiny because the MPC is super tiny. So in rank, in the representative vision model, the transmission mechanism is all about intertemporal Now, this was a simple example, but the same result holds true in medium-scale monetary ESG models, like the benchmark Smets and Waffles model. Now, the paradoxical thing is that, even though the model is called a new Keynesian model, it's not very Keynesian at all, because the size of a Keynesian multiplier is really tiny. And in fact, as John Cochrane nicely put it, this model should be really called the sticky price intertemporal substitution. It's very neoclassical at heart, in a way, this model. Okay, this is just an observation, right? This is just a transmission mechanism. So what is wrong with this aggregate intertemporal substitution logic? Now, this logic is sort of in contrast with much empirical evidence. Okay? Now, I obviously don't have the time, this is the place to summarize in detail the empirical evidence, but I would say there's a solid amount of empirical work that suggests that even in developed, in very developed high-income economies, not everyone is a permanent income consumer. There is a large share of what is called in the literature hand-to-mouth households with high marginal cost to consume out of transitory income and low sensitivity of consumption to the interest rate, which essentially, from the point of view of the model, they are not on their oil equity, on their individual oil equity. And there is a non-trivial distribution of marginal cost to consume across the population. Some households have high MPC, others are permanent income consumer very low, and there's a whole distribution. So these observations, this sort of body of empirical evidence, has two implications from the point of view of kind of economic insights. The first is that the wealth distribution and the portfolio composition of wealth determines the distribution of MPCs and the aggregate marginal propensity to consume. Okay? And the aggregate marginal propensity to consume is key in determining the size and the strength of this indirect general equilibrium effect of monetary policy. The second insight is that once you start thinking about a world with heterogeneous marginal cost of consumption, then even pure income redistribution, a shift of income across the distribution, can have real effects. Okay? So, in particular, by redistributing income towards high NPC households, the effects of monetary policy can be amplified. So, what we need essentially is a kind of framework to start developing these two insights and start measuring these two insights quantitatively. And in the last few years, I think a lot of progress has been made in the literature, and a new kind of macro framework is emerging. This macro framework, in a way, it's a very natural progression of quantitative macro, which for a long time progressed as kind of representative agent, kind of monetary ESG models on one side, and on the other side, heterogeneous agents, incomplete markets model that were mostly focused on kind of fiscal policy in the long run. So this new class of models merges these two approaches. It's sort of an Ayagare-Kozel-Smith meets Gallagher and Woodford. And obviously, the main advantage, as I said, is that you can think through the income distribution, the wealth distribution, and the effects that this has on the NPC and the application of monetary policy, and so on, which is what I'm going to focus on in the next 20 minutes or so. Excuse me. But I think that there is also something else which is attractive about this approach. Empirically, it's a unified approach to the analysis of micro and macro data. Okay? And I've seen recently a lot of exciting work that tries to extend the standard tools of Bayesian estimation that have been used in the estimation of ESG models, which combine together longitudinal panel micro data with time series to estimate this class of models. Conceptually, it's a unified framework to study both kind of short-run fluctuations and long-run dynamics of distribution. So in that sense, it still has a flavor, a little bit, of this kind of RBC, New Keynesian models, which are, which were essentially versions of the stochastic growth model, right? So versions to analyze the short run of a model that was designed to analyze the model. Also, they provide a unified framework to study together stabilization and redistributive policies. And in this world, any stabilization policy has redistributive implication, and any redistribution policy can be stabilizing or destabilizing. Okay, so there's a really these two policies are necessarily intertwined. And technically, it's now a lot easier and faster to solve these models, so these models are a lot more accessible. So let me offer in one slide one version of these models, which happens to be the one that I work with Cameron Moll, but there are many versions of this framework that are also extremely useful to analyze these topics. So the model that I'm going to work from now on essentially is one with a continuum of households who face uninsurable idiosyncratic income shocks, productivity shocks. They choose consumption, saving, and labor supply, and they can save in two assets, okay? Which we're going to call the liquid asset and the illiquid asset. The liquid asset in the model is basically government bonds, and the illiquid asset in the government is basically physical capital, okay? Or if you like, equities to a mutual fund that owns physical capital. In practice, the way we map these assets into the Service of Consumer Finance data on portfolio composition is, for liquid assets, we use cash, bank accounts, and government bonds. For illiquid assets, we use basically housing and 401ks, okay? And one key feature of this model, and I'll explain why it's important, is there is a transaction cost to move funds into the liquid account or out of the liquid account. Okay? You have to think like, okay, it's costly to withdraw from 401k, it's costly to extract equity from the house, it's costly to buy a house or to sell and upsize your house, and so on. It's always a very stylish way of capturing all these complicated asset structure in household asset structure in the economy, like this kind of first step. In equilibrium, the model determines both real returns, and in particular, because the liquid asset is liquid as a transaction cost, the equilibrium real rate on the liquid asset dominates the real rate on the liquid asset. So the liquid asset, from a certain perspective, is a very, very appealing asset to save, but also the liquid asset is appealing because it provides a way to smooth consumption that in the very short run, the liquid asset doesn't provide precisely because it's illiquidity. The remaining model ingredients are kind of standard. We have a nominal rate being set by a Taylor rule, and then a Phillips curve determines the relationship between inflation and economic. Okay, so what this model gives you is basically the ability to generate a very realistic wealth distribution, both at the top with fairly high concentration of wealth at the top and at the bottom. In particular, at the bottom, the model can generate a large share of these kind of hand-to-mouth households. So let me do a little bit of digression and move to the data and tell you about what the data say on the prevalence and the distribution of hand-to-mouth households. This is a plot that measures hand-to-mouth households on the survey consumer finance in the survey consumer finance from 1989 to 2019. It's a triennial survey where we define hand-to-mouth households as being those with low liquid wealth. Think basically less than 2 months of income, 2 months of earnings. The first thing that jumps at you is that there's about 30%, between 25 and 30% of households who are hand-to-mouth, according to this definition. This share is quite cyclical. It peaks in recessions, and it falls in expansions. And perhaps it comes to, it's kind of good news that if you look at 2019, which is basically just before the epidemic, we had historically one of the lowest shares of these households. So that's kind of good news in a way. The other thing that is important is to distinguish within this category two groups. Okay? So these are all households with low liquidity. But within this group, there are the poor, wealth poor households that have low liquidity and also low net worth in general, low net worth in the aggregate, and the so-called wealthy hand-to-mouth. These are low liquid wealth individuals who actually have some sizable investment in liquid assets. They could be because they own a house with a mortgage debt, because they have some savings in the 401k. But what matters for consumption smoothing, so liquid wealth, is very low. The typical, if you look at the data and you try to dig into who these guys are, the typical group is basically young homeowners. Okay? Homeowners who just bought a house, they have a large mortgage, and the mortgage payments are absorbing a lot of the cash flow for this household. Basically, they have large commitment expenditures. And the two-asset model is precisely able to generate this group of households, which are, as you can see, the majority of hand-to-mouth households. They're like two-thirds of them, while poor hand-to-mouths are only one-third. Okay? So the model gives you the ability to generate essentially a realistic wealth distribution, both at the top and at the bottom. And as a result, it gives you a fairly rich distribution of marginal rates to consume. This is a plot of the MPC out of a windfall of $500 over the first quarter as a function of liquid and illiquid wealth. Okay? What you can see here essentially is like these two ridges. Okay? There's a ridge of the MPC, two ridges where the MPC is very high, which is at zero and at the credit limit. This is sort of the credit limit here. And obviously, the MPC is very high, both at zero and the credit limit, and it's kind of decaying relatively quickly. But what is interesting is that the MPC remains large even for those households, let's say they are around here, that have very, very low amounts of liquid wealth, but they have some liquid wealth. Okay? These are the wealthy hand-to-mouth. I mean, obviously, there's not a very large share of mass of population on this point here, but there is some, as we saw. There is about 20% of households who are in this range here. Overall, you combine things together and you get a quarterly aggregate marginal profit on steel around 15%, which perhaps is not as large as what some empirical works seem to suggest. You know, work by Jonathan Parker and co-authors on the tax rebate, which is a kind of relatively clean, quasi-natural experiment, suggested this quarterly position maybe 20-25%, but still 15% is 30 times bigger than the MPC in the representation model that at the quarterly frequency is about 0.5%. Okay, so you can start seeing that because of this key difference between these two models, the general equilibrium effects are going to be much larger in this class of model relative to intertemporal. In fact, if you kind of take this model and you run a monetary policy, an expansionary monetary policy shock. Okay? And you see what happens in this model, and you decompose the impulse response into direct and indirect effect. Here's kind of what you get. Okay, so in the left panel, you have the aggregate consumption response in Hank and Rank to I think this is a 50, 25 or 50 basis point change in the nominal rate. In the middle panel, you have the decomposition in the representation model, and in the right panel, the decomposition in the heterogeneous. So the first observation I want to make is that the impulse response function for aggregate consumption are very similar across models. They're almost on top of each other. Okay, now this is it's sort of desired for this particular experiment. We pick a parameterization for which you get this kind of almost equivalence result between the two models in terms of aggregates. And I'll come back later on this point. But what is important here is the middle panel and the right panel that offer you the decomposition of the impulse response between direct and indirect effect, between the sort of this partial equilibrium and the general equilibrium income channel in the two models. And you see the transmission mechanism is very different. In Rank, it's mostly the direct channel that dominates. See, at least in the very short run, and in the long run, the indirect effects dominate, but it's still very small. And basically, the story is that, you know, there's a cap in the nominal rate, and this translates into a cap in the real rate, and through the aggregate order equation, that is intertemporal substitution, households consume more today and less in the future. That's it. That's the story now. In the heterogeneization model, you see that the intertemporal substitution is still there, right? And it is quantitatively relevant, but the dominant channel is our indirect effects. Okay, so what happens here? Basically, you know, at the very beginning, through intertemporal substitution, because the initial impulse has to happen through intertemporal substitution, there is an increase in the demand for consumption. This increase in demand for consumption increases demand for labor and increases employment and wages. And this additional labor income, partly or largely, depending on how the model is specified, goes to the low liquidity, high MPC households who increase further the demand for consumption. So this is the, you know, the general equilibrium Keynesian multiplier that is especially strong in this model because this aggregate demand channel is especially strong because of the high aggregate MPC. Okay, so the transmission mechanism is different, and this clearly has implication for, you know, the way we understand and think about monetary. Okay, very good. So let me come back on this point here. Okay, this you may think it's kind of surprising because you might have expected that in the heterogeneization model, perhaps there should be an amplification of the impulse through this large MPC. So let me move to the issue about amplification. Before I do that, I want to make one point clear that, you know, so far, essentially, I talked about basically the role of the wealth distribution, right? The wealth distribution and portfolio composition that determines the heterogeneity in MPC and the size of MPC, and therefore the starting point of the generator. Okay. From now on, I will mostly discuss amplification, and in amplification, the income distribution as a key role. Okay. So, Okay, before I move to amplification, there is one, I think, additional dimension of this model that I want to talk about because it's especially, I think, interesting in the way it can potentially be connected with the microdata, which is the transmission mechanism of the shock across the distribution. Okay, so here's a plot of basically the percentage change in consumption expenditures in the cross-section as a function of the percentiles of liquid wealth. You see it has kind of this shape. So let me explain where this shape is coming from. So again, you can split this response essentially between direct and indirect effects across the distribution. Across the distribution. You can do the decomposition that I showed you kind of agent by agent or percentile by percentile. So let me start from the direct effects. So in this model, as I said, there are about 30% of households who are liquidity constrained, basically, or close to being liquidity constrained, either because they are at the zero kink in the budget constraint. We have a kink at zero because there is a wedge between the borrowing and the saving rate, or because they are at the credit limits over here. For these agents, for these households, the direct intertemporal substitution channel is almost zero. Then, intertemporal substitution becomes more and more important throughout the distribution, as you can see, but it's still muted somewhat near the zero kink, near the borrowing constraint, because of the precautionary saving model. Okay? This is a model with occasionally binding constraint, and one thing that occasionally binding constraint do effectively to the precautionary saving model, they shorten the time horizon, the effective time horizon in another equation. Okay? So they reduce the size of the substitution effect. Remember that here is an expansion of monetary policy shock, so the interest rate falls, and these are households with a lot of liquid wealth for whom the income effect, the negative income effect, comes to dominate the substitution effect, and so you have a declining direct effect here because the income effect is very strong. The general equilibrium indirect effect through basically an increase in labor income generated by the stimulative monetary shock is obviously, as expected, especially strong for the high-income households who have a high MPC. And then, the MPC remains slightly higher here at the top, so this effect kind of declines, but it kind of dominates for the high-income households. The important thing is that to notice here that these different forces play out at different points in the wealth distribution, so that the transmission mechanism is kind of complex. And I want to conclude this discussion by saying that there is already some broad empirical support from microdata to this transmission mechanism across the distribution. I know of papers that use high-quality microdata, longitudinal microdata from Denmark and Norway, UK and the US, and my own work with Hirka, Slakalek, and Oreste Tristani. That uses the HFCS data for the EU area also provides some support to this method. Okay, so let me turn to amplification. So, as I said, you might have expected that perhaps a larger share of end-to-mouth households are kind of connected with the amplification of the shocks. And at least a first pass of the data seems to suggest that is the case. Okay? So this is it's a recent paper that puts together evidence from the euro area, different common monetary shock and different effects across different countries in the euro area. They seem to find a positive relationship between the cumulative effect of an expansion of monetary policy shock and the share of end-to-mouth households. In fact, fairly strong effects, you see, of the order of a factor of three across countries. So let me investigate a bit more deeply into the application. So I'm going to start from this equation, which relates basically in the change in individual consumption to the marginal price to consume and the change in individual income, where you have to think of the change in individual income as the change in individual income across the whole distribution, which is due to the monetary policy. Okay? It's easy to show that you can rewrite this equation here in this way. which is basically a product of the income weight, MPC, the elasticity of individual income to aggregate income. Okay, so basically how income at very point, at different points in distribution responds to the shock, times the change in aggregate income induced by the monetary policy. The total change in aggregate consumption induced by the change in income, what I call the indirect generative effect, can be obtained by just, you know, integrating across all households this expression, and you get this, this simple expression. So what you see here is that, I mean, obviously it seems to be true that, you know, the larger is the MPC, obviously the larger is the aggregate effect, which is something that the previous plot suggests. But what is also key, particularly key, is that what matters is the covariance, right? This kind of this covariance between this elasticity and the MPC. So there will be amplification if the monetary shock redistributes towards high MPC households. Okay, that's kind of one of the key lessons from this class of models. What makes things a bit more complicated is that the income composition varies across the distribution, right? This is sort of total income, but, you know, total income is given by labor income, capital income, business income, government transfers, and all these different income components respond differently to shocks and to monetary policy shocks. Okay, here's an example of the composition of income across the quantiles of the income distribution. You know, the bottom 20, the middle 20, and top 1%. So the bottom 20 is actually mostly government transfers. The middle 20 is labor income. The top 1% is kind of half and half labor income, but capital and business income are particularly important. So depending on, you know, which of these components respond the most, you know, you would expect maybe the MPC is highest here and lowest here. Then depending on how these three components respond, you can get different configurations of amplification or dampening even. And the other thing that I want to emphasize that is important is that the fiscal response matters, right? I mean, the fiscal response matters in these models because the fiscal response to the monetary policy shock, how the government budget constraint adjusts when, say, interest payments fall. Because in this model, Ricardian equivalence breaks down differently from the representative agent model. So I was just going to give you like a flavor of how things, complicated things can be, complex things can be. This is an estimate of the elasticity of labor earnings to change in income is what Fatih Güven and Motto Yogo and Sam Schiller-Wall have called kind of workers beta, the sensitivity of earnings across the distribution to aggregate income. This is not conditional monetary policy shock, conditional to any shock. So it's not exactly what we want, but it's kind of an unconditional estimate. And you can see that it's kind of, there is something that I think you would expect, right? That at the bottom, the elasticity is higher, precisely because of unemployment, of the extensive margin of employment, unemployment that affects a lot of individuals at the bottom of the permanent income distribution. But you see also very high elasticity for the very, very top of the earning distribution. And we think that this is related to kind of performance-based pay that is also extremely cyclical. Okay, so if you feed in these elasticities, for example, in this formula, it's not clear you're going to get amplification. It depends a little bit on distribution MPCs and other things. My last slide before I conclude. In the composition that I show you, I talk as if the MPC, the aggregate MPC is constant. But obviously, the aggregate MPC is an equilibrium object. It's given by the distribution of MPC, income weighted, and it also responds to the shock, right? In particular, what matters for the dynamics of the MPC and therefore amplification versus dampening is the precautionary saving motive. And here, countercyclical idiosyncratic risk, we know it's an important source of amplification of monetary policy shocks. Okay? We know that idiosyncratic risk is countercyclical; it increases recession, in particular, it's the skewness of the labor earnings innovation that increases in recession. After an expansion in monetary shock, unemployment risk falls, right? You go kind of from the red line to the blue line. So what happens is that the precautionary saving model weakens and the aggregate MPC rises. And this generates a further increase in consumption expenditures that further amplifies the initial role of the monetary shock. Okay, and I want just to say that this insight about the role of precautionary saving has been in this incomplete market literature in a long time, and I think Ricardo Cavaliero was perhaps one of the first to point this out in his one of his papers. All we're doing here, basically by merging this literature with this new Keynesian block, is to explain how all these things can be relevant for monetary policy. Okay, and my timer tells me that I'm out of time, and in fact, I'm on my last slide here. Okay, so just taking stock, we in this research program that many people have contributed with, many of whom I'm sure are listening to the conference, for example, Veronica included. The distribution of income and wealth is also central in monetary economics, empirically grounded heterogeneity alters, when introduced into this model, alters an important wealth transmission mechanism of monetary shock. The wealth distribution and portfolio composition determine the distribution of MPCs and the strength of the direct and indirect generally channels of monetary policy, which one dominates, and so through which basically channels you have to think through when you want to try to forecast or understand the effects of monetary. The income distribution and the composition of income determine the redistributive consequence of monetary policy and also the amplification or dampening of a monetary policy shock relative to, say, a baseline standard representation. And I, with this, I conclude. I thank you very much, and most of all, stay safe.
Thank you very much, Gianluca, for this very clear exposition, and for clearly highlighting why, as central bankers, we should also look at microdata and look at the distribution and understand these effects, basically. We already received some questions in the Q&A session. There were two questions that basically boiled down to the same, so I'll bundle them. They came from Carlo Altavilla and Klaus Mazu. Basically, the point is that in your paper, in your presentation, monetary policy is basically an interest rate policy. And the question is, how much do these distributional consequences really depend on the policy measure that the central bank deploys? I mean, we're going more and more into what you call non-standard or unconventional measures. So how would your conclusions change of the paper if you think, for instance, of QE instead of an interest rate policy for the channels? Thanks.
Yes, this is a great question. There is already some work being done that tries to understand the effects and the transmission channel of QE in this class of models. I'm going to cite one paper. I'm forgetting others, but it's a paper by Wei Kui and Vincent Sterk that uses a UCL, that uses precisely this framework to think about QE. Now, a couple of things. So the first is that I think this is a very natural, in a way, a very natural framework to think about QE, because you have these two assets, okay, which are kind of liquid assets, say government bonds or bank accounts, reserves, and the other one is this illiquid asset, so say housing, or if you want to think about the financial equivalent would be like mortgage-backed security. It's very natural to think about QE as doing a liquidity swap, for example, in these models. The Kui and Sterk paper is precisely about that. In terms of the composition that I talked about, the effect of QE are essentially entirely generic equilibrium effects. there is no direct effect on consumption. Okay, I'm thinking about the consumption side, household side. There's no direct effect of QE. Everything goes through their general driven effect on prices, on asset prices. And here's where I have to say this is not yet, this is a model that is not yet ready in a way for at least in the incarnation that I showed for this type of analysis, because you know, as Ricardo has highlighted in his presentation, you know, a huge component of the way we think about financial markets is risk, aggregate risk, the repartition of risk across assets and so on. And you know, new Keynesian models in general are quite bad at generating you know, equity, large equity premium, time varying equity premium, and so on. Now, again, there is interesting work being done, and I'm going to cite the paper by my colleague Moritz Lennel, who has introduced heterogeneous preferences, the heterogeneous risk aversion to this model. And by doing that, you can get basically larger equity premium, you can get time varying equity premium, the varying over the cycle. So that is, so I think the framework is getting ready to already to answer these type of questions. The race on, you know, in terms of like redistribution effect, going back to the beginning of my to the source of my talk. In terms of the distribution effect, it will be kind of a race between, you know, how strong the effects of QE are on, say, asset prices, and therefore something that at least on paper tends to favor the high income, high wealth people, versus the effect on sustaining labor demand and wages, which is something that would affect the lower end of the distribution. I think the jury is still out there, both empirically and theoretically, within the class of models.
Thank you very much. We have received also another question by Anton Nakov, which is whether monetary policy should explicitly target wealth or inequality, and if so, how?
Okay, so this is a question that's a, you know, that's the question, if you like, at this conference. I'm not going to give you a yes or no answer, obviously, but it's a great question. It's a question that is the object of again a number of papers at the very frontier of this literature. I'm going to cite two just because are the ones that they come to mind. Maybe three. There's one paper by Tom Sargent, Mike Golosov, Amon Bondari and co-authors, other co-authors. There's a paper by Xavier Ago and co-authors. And there is a paper by Florin Bielli and co-authors, which actually is kind of neat because it tries to address the issue analytically. So these are, they're complicated models. And the answer depends a lot on the social welfare function. It's a question about the policy, okay? So in terms of, we're in the Ramsey world. Right? Let's stay in the Ramsey world. It depends on the social welfare function that you write. You know, the social general social welfare function, the utilitarian social welfare function would have a motive for redistribution in this incomplete market model, the model for social insurance, and then there is the classical stabilization motive, obviously, that you have in the representative in your Keynesian one. Now, I can tell you that one thing that comes to that emerges from this literature. Almost universally, is that the answer depends on the existing fiscal policy that is available. Okay, so if fiscal policy is rich and is close to optimal, then fiscal policy should do the job of redistributing and providing social insurance. And then what is left for monetary policy is largely. Is largely kind of stabilization, okay? And let me just say that even if that is the case, okay, these class of models remain, I think, important because it tells you that the transmission mechanism of monetary policy is different. So the way the monetary policy stabilizes the economy is different from what you were previously thinking if you think for self-sufficient. So So the question is whether, you know, fiscal policy is close to optimal or not, or whether it's whether over dozen distribution, under dozen distribution, under provides social insurance and so on. So it's a question that I think can only be answered conditional on fiscal policy.
Many thanks. I have another question from Anton Nakov. But the first question was now whether monetary policy should target explicitly wealth or income inequality. His second question is, can inequality concerns inform questions on the optimal inflation rates, and you know, whether we should focus on inflation targeting versus makeup strategies? And you know, of course, makeup strategies very much here also in the limelight these days in central banking after the Fed's decision. So what would be your views on that?
That's another great question. So my view here is that there is maybe one important dimension that you know, that I think is interesting, will be interesting to develop within these models, which is that it's something that empirically has been shown that different households across in different points of the income and wealth distribution consume very different bundles. And as a result, they have different inflation rates, okay? They also hold different portfolios of nominal assets. And so they are also subject to inflation differently, depending on how much you know, nominal wealth they have in their portfolio. So overall, what I would say is that, you know, the redistributive impact and therefore you know the strength and the transmission mechanism is even a little more subtle than what I showed today, precisely because I think if you were to enrich the model with this element where there are different goods and people across the institution consume different bundles of these goods, and these different bundles of the goods respond differently to inflation, then I think the whole transmission mechanism of monetary policy and perhaps even inflation dynamics overall would be very different. Could be very, very, I don't know, somewhat different.